first step in our search for the Holy Grail takes us into the mysterious world of the Celts. The Celts came to Europe from the east, traveling west through the Danube Basin, the Alps, and into the mountains of Central Europe. With them, they brought their culture, rituals, and traditions. Magical powers have also been attributed to vessels. At a time when people often faced hunger, the Horn of Plenty had a special significance. It was eternally filled with food. Bowls, jugs, chalices, and cauldrons were all considered magical vessels.
The earliest Grail story is a poem in which Arthur and his men go in quest of a magical vessel, a cauldron, which cauldrons were regarded as magical very often in the old Celtic mythology. Then what happens is that the story of the quest is taken up in the Middle Ages, and the vessel is turned into a Christian object. But certainly there is a pagan background here.
According to Celtic tradition, the legendary King Arthur set off on a mysterious voyage to find the magic cauldron.
In all human cultures, drinking plays a special role. In many ritualistic practices, drinking serves a magical function. We know this to be particularly true of the Celts, who had magic vessels, vessels that could bestow salvation or special powers. This tradition is continued in the idea of the Holy Grail, the vessel that nourishes and brings salvation.
And the first stories of the Holy Grail were born. In the act of communion, Christians commemorate the Last Supper, when Jesus filled a chalice with wine to symbolize his blood. The chalice and the wine became symbols of eternal life. The events in the last days of the life of Jesus Christ are well known. The story of his crucifixion has been told, written and represented countless times. But there are lesser known sides to the story, and one of them involves the Holy Grail. According to legend, the Roman captain Longinus stabbed the crucified Jesus in the side with a lance. Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished merchant and a relative of Jesus, collected the blood of Jesus in the chalice used at the Last Supper. Many people believe that this chalice was the Holy Grail.
All of this was claimed by the Church, and this grail, that is the receptacle we call the grail, was made out to be the container of the blood of Jesus Christ, collected by Joseph of Arimathea upon his descent from the cross. Jesus was placed in the family tomb of Joseph of Arimathea himself. These legends and traditions form the basis of the myth of the Grail and the impassioned quest for the Grail pursued by King Arthur's knights. His knights were initially nothing but simple warriors, but they needed an ideal, the chivalric ideal of the Arthurian legends. It was a quest for perfection, symbolized by the Grail.
C'est la recherche de la perfection symbolisée par le Graal.
According to tradition, Joseph of Arimathea kept the chalice. But as a follower of Jesus, he was pursued, arrested, and sent to prison. Upon his release, he abandoned his homeland, and following an ancient trade route across the Mediterranean, he traveled via Rome to the south of France. Joseph is believed to have settled in Languedoc, together with some of the other disciples, including Mary Magdalene.
From an archaeological point of view, it's thoroughly conceivable that a distinguished man such as Joseph of Arimathea could have taken this vessel, which had been used on festive occasions such as Passover.
Where the Holy Grail was kept once it arrived in Europe, nobody knows. There are many conflicting accounts. One of the oldest beliefs is that Joseph, and possibly even Jesus himself, visited Britain and took the Holy Grail with him. Joseph went ashore in the south of England and travelled to what is now Glastonbury. And it was here that he spent the rest of his days.
There are versions of this Grail story, but in England, it was said that it was brought here to, of course, the town of Glastonbury wasn't here then, but that it was brought here soon after the crucifixion, and then it was lost, and Arthur's knights went in quest of it.
From this point on, the Holy Grail was closely associated with the legendary King Arthur and his knights. Camelot, the legendary castle of King Arthur, and the place from which the quest for the Grail began. Historians still argue over whether this castle ever really existed.
We have to be careful about Camelot. People sometimes think, oh, that was the capital of England in Arthur's time, but it wasn't. In all the stories of Arthur, Camelot is his headquarters. There's nobody there before him, there's nobody there after him. Now, of course, Camelot, as you see it in films and so on, could never have existed. There would never have been a great, magnificent medieval castle in the Dark Ages, in the 5th century or whenever it was. But it's quite possible that Arthur did have a headquarters, and there's quite a good reason to think that this was a place called Cadbury. Cadbury.
Camelot, Camelot, Camelot.
It's only a model.
Knights, I bid you welcome to your new home. Let us ride to Camelot.
We're knights of the round table. We dance where we're able. We do routines and call the scenes with footwork impeccable. We dine well here in Camelot. We eat ham and jam and spam a lot. We're knights of the round table. Our shows are for mid-able. So many times we give and rhyme to our quite unseen able. We're off the mad in Camelot. We sing from the diaphragm.
Have to push the pram a lot.
No, on second thoughts, so let's not go to Camelot. It is a silly place.
Right. Right.
Europe had been forced to accept a terrible defeat. The Holy Land had finally fallen to Muslim invaders. Humiliated, the Crusaders returned home with their hopes dashed, their dreams shattered and their faith shaken. They needed new meaning in their lives, and they found it in their quest for the Holy Grail. King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table never found the Holy Grail. Like the magical sword Excalibur and the mysterious castle of Camelot, nobody knows if Avalon was fact or fiction. We have reached the end of our journey, our quest for the Holy Grail. It has taken us from east to west, from the Celtic to the Christian era. But there is no real conclusion to our story. The Grail will forever remain elusive, as the lines are blurred between invention and reality, fantasy and history. The Holy Grail will always represent different things to different people. What is certain is that more than 8 centuries after the first stories were written, the Grail and King Arthur continue to stimulate our imagination. The quest for the Holy Grail goes on.